Good morning, AMC.
Good morning.
We're continuing with our Advent sermon series, preaching on the Advent Song of Ascents. Advent is about the waiting for the coming of Christ. And as a church, we chose this theme to ascend the mountain of God together. And this whole Christmas period is themed the Advent Song of Ascents. And last week, as we walked together, Pastor Leonard encouraged us to stand as signposts on the journey as we ascend the mountain of God. The songs of ascent were sung by God's people on this journey. And God's people, we are supposed to guide those around us as signposts on this journey. This week we continue in the journey also with the prophet Isaiah. And in Isaiah 35, God leads us on this journey called the Way. It is a way of holiness. It is the Lord's highway. It is the path where the redeemed of the Lord walk with Him to Zion. Zion is the place where God will dwell with His people. This morning, I want to explore a bit about the background of this chapter, Isaiah 35, when it was written, what's going on at the time, who are the major characters in play. And after trying to answer this question, where is the Lord's highway? When is the Lord's highway? I want to look at the question, where? Where is the Lord's highway? Where is the Lord's highway bringing us? How will the Isaiah prophecy be fulfilled? Once we know the where we are going, hopefully we can apply this word in our life as we too as a church ascend the mountain of God to Zion. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your love for us. We thank you for your word. We also thank you for your rain. And Lord, as a metaphor for your spirit, Father, we just pray that we soak in your word and your spirit this morning. Open up our eyes to see you. As you promised, open up our ears, deaf ears, to hear you. Open up our hearts to receive your eternal life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm reading from Isaiah chapter 35 from the New International Version. And if you have your Bibles, do read along with me. The desert and the parched land will be glad. The wilderness will rejoice and blossom. Like the crocus, it will burst into bloom. It will rejoice greatly and shout for joy. The glory of Lebanon will be given to it, the splendor of Carmel and Sharon. They will see the glory of the Lord, the splendor of our God. Strengthen the feeble hands. Steady the knees that give way. Say to those with fearful hearts, be strong. Do not fear. Your God will come. He will come with vengeance. With divine retribution, He will come to save you. Then will the eyes of the blind be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then will the lame leap like a deer and the mute tongue shout for joy. Water will gush forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. The burning sand will become a pool, the thirsty ground bubbling springs. In the haunts where jackals once lay, grass and reeds and papyrus will grow. And a highway will be there. It will be called the Way of Holiness. It will be for those who walk on that way. The unclean will not journey on it. Wicked fools will not go about on it. No lion will be there, nor any ravenous beast. They will not be found there. But only the redeemed will walk there, and those the Lord has rescued will return. They will enter Zion with singing. Everlasting joy will crown their heads. Gladness and joy will overtake them, and sorrow and sighing will flee away. This is the word of the Lord. What a joyful passage! You know, there's so much hope in Isaiah 35 for the people of God. Whom in the wilderness doesn't want a complete turnaround of their lives, where flowers bloom, where you are assured no animal will attack you? You know, prophecies like this, prophecies of promise, they are to be fulfilled. The issue is, how will this prophecy be fulfilled? What did the Jews understand about this prophecy when Isaiah the prophet said it to them? You know, Isaiah invites the people of God, the redeemed of the Lord, on a journey on this place he calls the Lord's highway. But where is this Lord's highway headed? It is headed from the deserts into Zion. It ascends from the dry plains up the mountain of God. And Zion is the place where God is worshipped and is the hope that God will dwell with His people there. It's a beautiful 180-degree turnaround of your life, a complete restoration of weakness to strength, barrenness to splendor, sickness to life. You know, how many of you have visited a desert before? Not many. Oh, a few. A few. We live in a, I've never visited a desert. Well, I know it's supposed to be hot, inhospitable. And the picture you see on the screen is a picture of Death Valley in the United States. You know, scientists say that Death Valley, this desert, is one of the hottest places on the earth. The average summer temperature in Death Valley is about 45 degrees Celsius. Can you imagine that? The highest recorded temperature in Death Valley was 56.7 degrees Celsius. 57.6 degrees Celsius. That's super hot. You know, when I cook, I aim for an ideal internal temperature of a steak of 55 degrees. So the temperature in Death Valley is hotter than that of cooked meat. You know, the Singapore Marathon just concluded, and I know a couple of people, AMC, ran the marathon, and the marathon had about 40,000 runners running. Death Valley also has a marathon. It has an annual marathon, but the conditions there are so oppressive that they only let 250 people run every year. The running conditions are so terrible that on the sign-up form, there's a disclaimer that there may be last-minute cost changes, a possibility of cancellation of the marathon without any refund because of this unpredictable, inhospitable place. You know, in fact, these cancellations are not uncommon in Death Valley. In the last 33 years, the marathon was cancelled 3 times because it was impossible to run. But you know, even in such a terrible place, even in such harsh conditions, Death Valley is a place where flowers bloom. About once a decade, Death Valley experiences what is known as a super bloom. The entire desert is covered in wild flowers. Yes, this slide is the same picture as the Death Valley slides in the past few slides. And Death Valley, normally, Death Valley receives about 4 to 5 centimeters of rain every year. But there are exceptional years where there are extended periods of rain and the whole desert bursts forth with flowers. The last Death Valley superbloom occurred in 2016 and before that, 2005 and 1998. Yes, deserts can burst forth and blossom when the conditions are just right, when the rain soaks into the ground, like this heavy rain. Actually, I like heavy rain because I have a balcony, and if it just drizzles a bit, the balcony gets very dirty, but the plants don't get watered. I want heavy rain. I thank God for the rain so that I don't have to water my plants. And I go back and the balcony is not clean, but at least it's not the dirty balcony style. And the plants are watered. See, when dry ground receive nourishment, they are bathed in the right conditions, they bloom, they grow, and life comes out of death. Isaiah 35 was written in a difficult situation, in a dryness, in a wilderness of sorts for the people of God. You know, last week, Pastor Lynette explained that Isaiah was a prophet. He lived in the 7th or 8th century BC. And at that time, Israel, where's Israel? It's a little dot at the corner there. Israel was a divided kingdom. Israel in the north, Judah in the south. And immediately after our passage, there is a narrative in Isaiah 36 to 39, which I encourage you to read. And it helps us understand what's going on in Israel, what's going on in Judah at the time. And in that passage, the northern kingdom, Israel, was probably defeated. And you see the mighty Assyrian Empire moving across the globe, or the land. And the Assyrian king, Sennacherib, and his massive army was on the edge of Judah territory and was ready to invade Judah. If you look at a map, if you know the numbers of people, it seemed like a foregone conclusion. It probably looked like something like Russia and Ukraine. You know, 10 months ago, if you look on paper, Russia had this massive army and people thought Ukraine would be overrun in a matter of weeks. 10 months on, The Russian army's initial gains seem to be pushed back by Ukrainian forces, although the war is still going on. On paper, it's the same. The Assyrian army that conquered Israel should have easily overrun Judah. However, Isaiah 36 to 39 records that Judah and King Hezekiah were miraculously spared the judgment coming from Assyria. Isaiah 37, 36 records that there was this angel of the Lord, and he miraculously came into the Assyrian camp that was outside Judah, and he killed 185,000 people, Assyrian soldiers. The defeated king, Sennacherib, returned to his capital, Nineveh, and there he was murdered by his own sons, and God's deliverance came. At the end of this whole narrative in Isaiah 39, verse 3 and 4, the king of Judah at the time, Hezekiah, he made a terrible mistake. He tried to broker uncertain peace, a temporary peace, by showing some Babylonian envoys all the treasures of Judah. You know, Babylon was a power on the rise, trying to outdo Assyria. And even when the prophet Isaiah came to scold Hezekiah and say that, you know, what have you done? Why do you do this? The king of Judah, Hezekiah, he selfishly said, "The word of the Lord you have spoken is good," Hezekiah replied. For he thought there would be peace and security in my lifetime. Hezekiah thought that Assyria was being pushed back, and he tried to broker a temporary peace, a peace for himself in his lifetime, but he didn't look out for his country, Judah, for their continued safety. You know what happened? The Babylonian Empire eventually rose up to defeat the Assyrians and conquered Judah and the southern kingdom and carted off all the Jews into Babylon, into exile. In the book of Isaiah, it's a book written in two parts. Isaiah 1 to 39 was actually written during this time in the 7th and 8th century BC, when the northern kingdom, Israel, was falling to Assyria. But Judah, the southern kingdom, as we saw, as I briefly described, they were still at war with Assyria. They looked like they were about to be conquered, but God delivered them. Isaiah 1 to 39 was written to a people that was about to face judgment of God, because they had turned away from God. And the prophecies that we read in Isaiah 1 to 39, and we read as a church earlier on, the prophecies were against God's people that were about to be taken captive, about to be captured by Assyria and Babylon. After Hezekiah brokered this temporary peace in Isaiah 39, if you read carefully from Isaiah 40 onwards, these were prophecies not delivered to a people that were about to be captured. These were prophecies delivered to a people already captured. These were prophecies given to people who were already in exile. So Isaiah 40 to 66, or some scholars call it 2nd Isaiah, some scholars even break it down to a 3rd Isaiah, they were written for Jews that were in exile in Babylon somewhere in the 6th century BC. So Isaiah was written, 40 to 66, was written to a people on whom judgment had already come. So hang on, stay with me. So from the he tell it from the audience that the chapters are written to. So who wrote this 2nd Isaiah? That is a huge subject of debate among scholars. Of course, God in his wisdom could have given the original Isaiah in the 8th century BC a word for people 200 years later. That's a possibility. But I think a good explanation is that there was a school of Isaiah's followers who survived in the exile, and a few hundred years after Isaiah's life, they were inspired by the Holy Spirit to write to the Jews and continue the Isaiah prophecy. Actually, whoever wrote this, whenever it was written, it doesn't matter. But what I want to say is that we can look at Isaiah in two blocks. How does it help us? Well, the Isaiah passage in Isaiah 35 that we read does speak of the Lord's highway, does speak of a deliverance. But where is the Lord's highway taking God's people? You know, Judah may have thought that they were on the Lord's highway and they found a temporary peace in Isaiah 39. But this is not the Lord's highway that Isaiah 35 promises. If you read on in Isaiah 43, in a time of exile, there's a repeat of the Isaiah 35 prophecy where streams will come up in the desert, springs appear in the wasteland. So the Isaiah 35 prophecy actually stretches beyond the time of Judah, in fact, way beyond the time of the Jews. The Lord's highway that the prophet Isaiah invites all of us on is more than just the victory of Judah. The Lord's highway is more than the hope of exiled Jews. The Lord's highway is about the coming of a true and righteous king. And Isaiah 35 prophecy is partly fulfilled in the advent, in the first coming of Jesus Christ. And the people of God were always on a journey. If you read the whole thrust of the Old Testament, the people of God are on a journey. And we as a people of God are invited on a journey. In the Old Testament, the people of God were on this journey from Egypt to the promised land to exile, exile back to the promised land. But even when the people returned back to the promised land, all was not well. People are still hungering for a Messiah. Even when they build up their new home, they're still hungering for a hope beyond what they can see. And somewhere in between the Old and the New Testament, there were these long periods of silence. God did not speak. No prophet around. And the people of God waited and waited. But all this waiting is not for naught. Jesus fulfilled the prophecy. And in Matthew 11, he said that. And we understand now that Isaiah 35 is a messianic prophecy. It's fulfilled by Jesus in his coming. In the Advent, we anticipate Jesus' arrival in the world, into our lives, to turn dry and barren deserts into fields of flowers. This passage was quoted by Jesus himself in Matthew 11. What happened? John the Baptist was in prison, and John the Baptist sent his disciples to ask Jesus if Jesus was indeed the Messiah that Israel was waiting for. And Jesus said this about himself in Matthew 11. Jesus said, "Go back, report to John what you hear and see." And he quotes Isaiah. "The blind receive sight, the lame walk, those who have leprosy are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and good news is proclaimed to the poor." And Jesus took it a bit further. It's more than the restoration of the Jewish people. It's a restoration of all people. You know, when Jesus quoted from the Isaiah prophecy, he was a bit cheeky and he altered some things in the prophecy. Isaiah promised healing for the blind, the deaf, the lame, the mute. Jesus did make reference to the blind, the deaf, and the lame. He left out the mute, I don't know why, but he added two other categories of people. Jesus came to heal the lepers, people who were considered unclean, the outcasts of society, the untouchables. And Jesus also said this, "The dead are raised." You know, miraculous healing was promised, and I can understand. But "the dead are raised" is a prophecy of Jesus that far exceeds the prophet Isaiah. You know, Jesus is saying, "I'm offering you life, true life. Not the curing of your ailments merely, but the entire prophecy of 35 will be fulfilled, where the deserts, the wastelands will bloom and come up into life." Jesus, in his ministry, did all these miraculous things. We read that Jesus raised 3 people from the dead. But you know, the true life that Jesus promises is eternal life. We just went through the book of Matthew as a church. And in the last of the Jesus teachings, which is a passage that we didn't preach from, but just before the Last Supper, Jesus taught about this, about separating the sheep and the goats. And in the last of this series of teachings before the Last Supper and before his death, he taught that he will come again in Matthew 25:31. He will come again in glory, and all the angels will be with him on his glorious throne. And he says he comes to separate the sheep from the goats, the righteous from the wicked. In verse 34, the righteous go to everlasting life. But the unrighteous, the wicked, will go to everlasting punishment in verse 46. And this is the end of the Lord's highway. This is the end of where the Lord's highway is bringing us. This is the final consummation of the Isaiah 35 prophecy. On this way, the redeemed of the Lord, those who walk on this way, they will enter Zion with singing. They will enter with an everlasting crown of joy on their heads. And only at this time, finally, all sorrow, all sighing will flee away. So Isaiah 35 points far beyond his own time, beyond Hezekiah, beyond the return of exiled Jews from Babylon, beyond the first coming of Christ. The Lord's highway and the Isaiah prophecy points to the true advent, the second coming of Christ. This Advent season, we wait. We celebrate the first coming of Christ. Jesus coming as a lowly little baby in a manger. But don't forget that the first Advent points to the second Advent, where Jesus comes not as a lowly servant, but as the King of Kings, the glorious Lord of Lords. Isaiah 35 gives us a clue of all this. Who desires to walk on the Lord's highway? Who wants to walk on this way that leads to eternal life? You know, perhaps most people want to walk on the way. If the promise is so good, I want to walk on the way. But who can walk on the way? Who can enter this road? Who wants to drive a car? Who wants to drive a car? Nobody wants to drive a car. Then pass all your cars to me, please. Okay, I think everyone wants to drive a car. I mean, youngsters, all the youths can't wait to drive the car. But not anyone can drive a car. What do you need? A driving license. First, you need a driving license and you need a COE. You know, the good news is that the COE prices have gone down, but it's still way above $100,000. So not everyone can drive a car. Who wants to get into a good school? You know, I believe everyone wants to get into a good school, a good university. But there are entrance requirements, tests to pass, certificates to obtain before you can go to the school of your choice. Who wants a good job? Who wants to be the CEO of a company? Everyone. Everyone wants their ideal job, but there are interviews to go through, testimonies to write, many, many, many rounds. So who can enter the Lord's highway? The way to Zion, the way to eternal life. Isaiah tells us specifically who is going on the Lord's highway, who will be traveling on the Lord's highway. First, it is a way of holiness. It is for people who walk on the way. Not just the people in Jerusalem who are sitting tight. It's for people who walk on the way, who walk with God, who walk with Jesus. It's a people who journey with God, who journey with other pilgrims and are walking on the way. That's the first thing. It's for people who walk. Two, the second characteristic of these people is that only the redeemed will walk there. Only those whom God has rescued will walk there. And it says this in verse 9 and 10. So who gets to enter Zion, the place where God will dwell with His people? Those who have been rescued with Jesus, by Jesus, and those who walk with Him. Those who have accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior and continue to walk and journey with Jesus on the way, who are anchored on His Word, who abide in His presence. You know, earlier I talked about super blooms in dry and barren deserts. And these desert plants are amazing. You know, the seed of the desert plant can survive for years, buried deep in the ground. If you look at the date of the super blooms, the seeds stay dormant and buried for more than one decade. But when do the seeds sprout? The park rangers that take care of Death Valley say that it's not the sudden heavy downpour that causes the special seeds to sprout. There needs to be this prolonged, slow drenching of the soil, a continuous falling of the rainwater that soaks deep into the soil where the seeds are. You see, the seed has a special outer coating that will ensure that all the conditions are right before they will sprout. Because if a sudden downpour comes and the seed sprouts and the next day is hot again at 56.7 degrees, the seed will die. So the seeds have this natural insurance policy to ensure that they don't sprout quickly merely to be scorched by the hot desert sun. So some of the seeds are covered with a special layer of wax. Some have a special protein on the outer coat. Some have a chemical, which all of these things require a generous amount of water, a prolonged watering to erode the covering and tell the seed, now the time is right, the conditions are right now. And then the whole desert will bloom together. And these seeds are like those who enter the Lord's highway. Those who sprout and come up to life are those who walk with Jesus, who are anchored in His Word, who abide in His presence, who are soaked in His presence and His Word. Those that walk on the highway, those are soaked in the Word of the Lord. They will experience the joy of the Lord's highway. These are the ones that will bloom like the desert flower. The redeemed and the rescued must continue to walk with Jesus on the way. The redeemed and the rescued must continue to be anchored in His Word and to abide in His presence. This is the way. The way is a journey. The way is an ascent to the mountain of the Lord. The way is life in Jesus. And all of Jesus' teaching make this very clear. You know, I want to make it clear, it's not about earning your salvation and doing things, but it's really about journeying with Jesus, understanding who He is, living with Him as a friend, a brother, trusting Him as a Savior, as a provider, obeying Him as a master. This is the journey of the Lord's highway. And the message from Old to New Testament has been the same. It is not just a promise of life. It is a promise of life everlasting. Do you want to walk on the Lord's highway? You must accept the rescue and redemption that is found in Jesus, number one, and continue to walk on the way with Him. You know, what else can we apply when we look at the context of Isaiah 35? What else can we glean from knowing the brief history lesson of the when? You know, whatever your situation, when we look at the context of Isaiah 35, God is not done yet. God is not done yet with you. God is not done yet with you until Jesus comes. You know, maybe all is looking well for you in your life. You look around your life, you feel satisfied with what you have. You think you found peace. You think you found happiness. You think you are living in a personal Shangri-La. You are happy with the Singaporean dream. You look forward to an early retirement. You know, those of us who seem to have everything, the Scripture tells us to look for even more glorious joy on the Lord's highway. Isaiah 35 is not just about the peace experienced in Isaiah 39, where there's a temporary peace. It points to a greater joy. It points to the complete restoration of everything, and that is the Christian life. So don't look to the temporary comforts. Don't look to the peace that is provided in this life and chase the things that are temporal. You know, walking on the way is walking the way of Christ. You know, even though Hezekiah himself heard with his own ear Isaiah 35, he was simply satisfied and says, "Thank God I have peace and security in my own lifetime." And he chased the riches. He chased the temporary satisfaction when actually a more glorious promise was given to him. Hezekiah settled for the goodness of this life. Don't chase a dream. Don't settle for the goodness of this life. And the Lord's highway will bring you to a place that surpasses all the good of this life. You know, before God called me into ministry, do you know what my dream was? Do you know what I was chasing? I dreamt of early retirement. I thought that was the most important goal in my life, and I had a number in mind, and my magic number was 55. I wanted to retire when I was 55 and kick back and enjoy life. But you know, God had other plans. You know, God spoke to me one day and asked me this question: "Have you finished building your house? Can you come and build my house now?" And I realized that I was settling for the good of this life, when I should be walking on the Lord's highway, walking with Jesus closely, asking Him, what is the path He wants me to take? Lord, how will You use this insignificant life and make it significant in Your eyes? You know, in this struggle, I answered the call of the Master to serve Him full time and to subordinate all the good of this life. I'm not saying that the things of this life are bad, they are good, but subordinate the good of this life for the ultimate good, to find the favor of God by doing what He wants, by walking where He wants me to go. It's not that you shouldn't aspire to a good education, a good job, a nice house. These are good things. But if the good things of this life crowd out the most important thing, the goodest thing, then you are in trouble of stepping out of the Lord's highway. Stepping out of the path that God wants you to walk on. Yes, other paths may have an occasional flower, but if you're not on the Lord's highway, if you're not walking in the Lord, you won't get to see a super bloom in your life. You will not get to experience a time when you're completely immersed in the glory and splendor of God. So don't give up the small goods for the ultimate good. God is not done yet. Maybe you're not chasing a dream. Maybe you feel like you're just getting by. That I'm talking nonsense. You will never get a good job. You will never get a good house. You will never make ends meet. But let me assure you that God is not done with you yet. Even when things are bleak, the down and outs are promised redemption if they trust in God and continue to walk with Him on the way. The promise of God is this: if you stick with Jesus, He will surely come to save you, and often in the way you least expect it. The promise is this: be strong, do not fear, because God will come. Deliverance will come, restoration will come, true life will come. In the prophecy, we are assured that Jesus will come and meet all of our needs. He promises true redemption, song of joy in our hearts, wiping away of sorrow and sighing. Is there anything in your life that you feel is a dead-end road going nowhere? A strained relationship? Dead-end job? Someone that's bullying you, oppressing you? You know, bring it to the Lord and trust that He truly is the one who can make deserts bloom, make hopeless situations joyful. Even through the silent years, I promise you, God's redemption will come. And the final point I want to make is that the Lord's highway is a journey. And we've adopted this theme of journey as a church. God invites us on this journey. He invites other people on this journey as well. We are not walking alone. The Lord's highway is a journey, and it's better to walk with someone else. The Isaiah 35 prophecy is addressed to people, God's people, not a singular person, but plural people. The Lord's highway will be called a way of holiness. It will be for those who walk on the way, those who walk on the way. There are many people walking together with us in this journey of life. And it's good to not let it accidentally happen, but purposefully, intentionally walk with people, commit to walk with people. Now, there was this Adidas commercial many years back trying to promote team sports, and he used this song. One is the loneliest number that you ever do. Okay, maybe you don't get it. You know. So going alone can be lonely. It says team sports are more fun. Buy our stuff so we can participate with your squad wearing the three stripes together. Why not journey on the Lord's highway with other people? How do we do that? Wendy invited those who are new to come. Maybe you're new to church. Maybe you've been in church for a few years, but you're not walking with people. You don't feel like you're walking with people. You know, the best way to walk with people, in my experience, is in a cell group or any other group that forms to meet together that are Christian brothers and sisters committed to regularly walking with one another, anchoring in God's Word, abiding in His presence through worship and prayer. You know, other pilgrims, for me, other Christians, are a means of God's encouragement as I walk on God's highway. It is good to journey with peers on the Lord's highway. It is good to have mentors, people who have gone on. Pastor Lynette said last week, signposts. It's good to look around and see a signpost, a mentor, someone that has brought us along this journey. Someone who has gone on and can guide us on the way. In your life, in some seasons, did you have someone who was willing to reach out to you, to give you a helping hand? A mentor that was kind enough to take time to speak to you? Was there someone who took the trouble to walk with you a portion of the way? Well, the first and only cell group I joined when I was an adult is the current cell group that I am in. And in that CG, there were two older brothers in Christ that took the time to guide us as we were young adults. They were about 10 years older than us and the rest of the group, and they took some time to mentor us, to guide us when we were in our 20s. And when I was in my late 20s, these two guys took me and another CG member aside and said that the cell group is getting too big. And now, in terms of numbers, we need to multiply. They have walked with us for this season, and it's now time for the two of us to lead at least half of the CG. But with fear and trepidation, the two of us took on this role as CG leaders, and it was a blessed journey of ups and downs, walking on this Lord's highway with other CG members. As a cell group, we've gone through weddings, birth of children, we've seen each other through death in a family, and I could not have done it without the support of my cell group. And although the mentor that I mentioned is not in the cell group, it is this mentor that helped me through a season in life. You know, when God called me into full-time ministry many years later, and he was not in my life anymore, the first person that I told, other than my wife, was this CG mentor, who I didn't call for years. But when I was in a season of my life, when I needed some direction, I needed a signpost, I remember I had this signpost before. And I called him, and he came to my house, and he helped me discern, and he encouraged me to answer God's call. Right now, I don't see him very often as well, but I know that we will always be there for each other. And at the end of the Lord's highway, when I get to the end of the Lord's highway, I will see him. Has anyone mentored you? More importantly, can you pass it on to the next generation? As you walk on the Lord's highway, if you see someone that needs help, someone who is struggling, can you help them? It may not be very obvious someone is struggling, but we can always reach out our hand. Can you reach out? Can we as a church, as a community, journey on the Lord's highway together? You know, church, in this period of Advent, as we wait for the arrival of Jesus on Christmas Day, remember we are all on this journey. We are journeying on the Lord's highway. The Lord's highway is a way of the redeemed and the rescued of Jesus. The Lord's highway is a way where the people of God commit to walk with him, to walk with Jesus, to be anchored in his word and to abide in his presence. And because we are on the Lord's highway, our destination is eternity. Because we are on the Lord's highway, God has a lot to be done with our life. Our God is not done with our life yet. There's still much to give him. There's still much to contribute. So take time to ask God, where is this highway supposed to lead you in your life? And even though you may feel old, remember the destination is eternity. No matter how old or young you are, there's still a long way to go. As the Lord's highway is a journey for all his people, let us commit to journey with other pilgrims. Commit to journeying with other people. It may be a cell group. It may be a mentor relationship for a season. Reach out to other people who are on the way. Like Wendy said, don't rush off. Let's see where the way leads us as a church. Reach out to those who need encouragement on the way. In a church, let us journey together. And I promise you, when we journey together, we will reach the end of the Lord's highway together. We will enter Zion singing together, where there's everlasting joy and it will crown our heads, where gladness and joy will overtake us, where sorrow and sighing will finally flee away. Amen.